Well, today I wanted to touch on this topic of deplatforming and censorship that has been going on. I think it's pretty much in everyone's radar, right, Ben? Like a lot of people would know at least a few famous people and a few even not so famous people on Facebook whose pages disappeared, people who had trouble getting, Patreon payments, people who, let's just say had a YouTube channel that, had some problems and suddenly now they can't post or their whole channel is gone. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh, sure. It's really frustrating. You know, I've been banned from Facebook just for asking the wrong questions or talking about the wrong topics. And I mean, from my perspective, it certainly appears that if you lean towards the right, if you've got a conservative kind of attitude, you're more likely, to be banned or barred or deplatformed. Is that as you see it?
Yeah, that's one thing. And sometimes it can be capricious seeming, like sometimes what can happen like this, Ben, where you just have, say you have a platform, like there was this big platform called Gab, it still is actually out there, competitor to Twitter, and people out there use it and they advertise themselves as, hey, we're not going to censor or, ban or shadow ban you like Twitter does. And so they had all kinds of people using Gab as a platform to say their, short little segment words and drop their links and such. Well, what happened, unfortunately, was the alleged Pittsburgh shooter of some months ago happened to be someone who was using that platform. And what that meant was that all kinds of trouble, like, descended, meaning, like, you had FBI and others breathing down their back, and then all of a sudden, all of Gab's main support, like their hosting, their payment platform, excuse me, their payment platform where they got their payments, everything, a lot of things were all they had to suddenly navigate to other places. And that was very time consuming and expensive. So they didn't do anything. All they did was just happen to open up a forum of free speech and someone on their platform spoke. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's crazy. So, it's really frustrating, isn't it? Give us more background. Like, why is this topic important to you? You know, how did this start for you?
Well, that's a good point. So, I've been a long time consumer of all kinds of podcasts and alternative media, trying to figure the world out. I came to many of these ideas that some you might be aware of, like voluntarism or anarcho-capitalism, for example.
Yeah.
You know, like that. I started becoming aware of those ideas in 2009 and was seeking out a greater understanding of this world because I moved from Vermont, the state of Vermont in the U.S., to Hawaii, and suddenly I had high-speed internet and I could sort of get a lot more information, while at the same time I had a lot more traveling to and from the school I was going to. So it was a lot of free time to be, like, consuming more information. And I got really wrapped up in not just consuming it, but eventually I found that I had a voice of my own. I had some knowledge of critical thinking skills, one called the trivium method of critical thinking. I had some ability to explain the method of nonviolent communication, my own applications of the two. Basically, like with critical thinking skills like the trivium, you balance your mind. With NVC skills, you have a chance to balance your emotions or balance your heart. You put them together and it's pretty kung fu for mind and heart, you know. And I got invited on a whole bunch of podcasts, being a kind of a professional pod guest, as it were, just to show up and give my voice out there on these topics. And I was really having a great fun time of that. Didn't really make any money, Ben, but, you know, had a great fun time and made a lot of awesome connections. People like Brett Vinant from the School Sucks podcast, people like Richard Grove from TragedyandHope.com, and there's like a lot of, you know, smaller shows that some of which have pod faded. They've faded away, basically. I found you out there. I was looking at you and your story of success, Ben. It was fascinating. So I kept an eye on you, you know. And then so, you know, basically I've been working behind the scenes as a consultant for some of these people, like I mentioned, these podcasters. Like I'm in these strategy groups called mastermind groups where we get together and the biggest problems that these guys would have, they lay it out one at a time, you know, one person per week. And we all put our heads together to solve them, basically. We're like little think tanks. And
give me an example. What would be an example of the kind of, like, who would you work with? What kind of problem would they have? And what kind of solution would you provide?
Ah, so I'd be working with various, let's just say, Brett Venat of the SchoolSucksProject.com, School Sucks Podcast. He's out there. It's definitely a rising star in alternative education, and he's basically in the hot seat today for the mastermind I'm in with him, and he'll be showcasing what his website's going to look like, I'm hoping. He'll be like showing like that. So we're going to be going over all elements of his marketing campaign, his copywriting, things of that nature. That's just an example. Mm-hmm. So I've been doing this work for a while, and I kind of got nicely connected 3 years ago with my friend Matt Raymer over in the Philippines. He's actually from Kentucky originally, but he lives there permanently. And for 3 years, I privately consulted with him. And during that time, I got to wait till the right time to pitch this idea of making this business contentissafe.com, where we basically can take all of his IT skills and set people up who make podcasts, that's for folks like you, Ben, and make it bulletproof against being deplatformed off of any platform that you're on, meaning that if we work with you ahead of time, we can get it ready so that if YouTube drops the big hammer on you or suddenly a Facebook page disappears, if we're working ahead of time, we could pop you back up there for sure, but also we could get you up on censorship-resistant platforms such as BitChute and DTube, that's like YouTube analogous, such as Minds and Steemit, which would be analogous to Facebook, and Gab, which is analogous to Twitter. And so those are methods that I like to work on. It's a new startup company, and so we got some fun work ahead of us.
Wow, I love it. So I love it how you've taken this thing and you've seen it as an opportunity to provide a service. That's fantastic. I mean, there's something funny about that. I mean, there's something really ingenious and kind of, I don't know if craft is the right word, but kind of like being one step ahead. It reminds me, what's that movie with Leonardo DiCaprio where he's always one step ahead and he's outsmarting everyone and that kind of thing?
Catch Me If You Can.
There's something about it. Reminds me a little bit. I had an old friend. I was once getting stressed over something. I don't know if it was like the property market or I don't know, whatever it was. Something was winding me up. And he said to me, like, you know, just see it as an opportunity. There's an opportunity in everything, kind of thing. And that's wicked that that's what you're doing.
It is awesome. I got to say, well, it's been 3 years working in these mastermind groups, working for folks like Kevin Geary of Six Figure Grind and Nathan Frazier, who does the Nathan Frazier show. And these folks who, you know, have a much more prolific voice out there in the alternative media community and much, you know, I would say more successful personally business-wise. And I get to still see how do they solve problems for each other and how do I step up and help them solve their problems. And then certainly I get to see how they help me solve mine. It's kind of like this, Ben. It's like we're in the hot seat every, 6 or 7 weeks or so. We're in the focal point of our problems are on display. And we're ready to showcase, here's my new business idea, here's what I'm doing, here's my campaign. And we have to take the criticism. So that's kind of like getting a bunch of lemons thrown at you, And then those lemons, man, take those lemons out and make lemonade out of them. So when they ripped apart this business idea of content is safe, it really helped me build my copywriting. It helped me focus my, how am I going to build this? So, I'm in the wee early stages, if you've ever built a website, a real business website, where you start off and you've got a series of stacked plans. And I just got to the stage where we're actually offering the services in trade for testimonial, that kind of thing, and then kind of an intro rate. It's super exciting. I'm sure you've done this, half a dozen times.
Right. I'm just trying to piece together. I'm just trying to assimilate and understand what you're saying as you say it. So it's almost like you're making a backup of everybody's content and stuff and then perhaps uploading it to other platforms. How did you describe it? You called the other platforms what was it? There was a word you used.
Censorship resistant platforms. So you're right. If you were taken down off of YouTube and we're working with you ahead of time, we are making copies of your content, that you have access to as well. I mean, that's the way it would be. And we can make simplistic copies, which is that means that we've got access to the Dropbox that you put your content in. Hopefully you're smart. If you're a content producer, you out there listening to me right now, if you're smart, you're making off-site copies of your content because, you know, you don't want everything just on-site. What if something goes wrong? Like your house burns down in those strange California fires. Ooh, you know? but you know what I'm saying is, yeah, making copies is one thing. Having a plan instituted so that alternative channels can be ready and instantly started to be populated, if you've kept a copy of if you've made a campaign to capture your subscribers' emails, which we encourage all of our clients to do, so you have a way of reaching them in case you get shut down. You could reach them and say, hey, at least you get a portion of them, and say, hey, we got taken down, they put the hammer on us, but hey, we're over here and we're over here and we're over here. We just got repopulated by contentissafe.com. We're up there, you know? So it's kind of like that. See, I am the chief marketing officer. I'm not the chief tech of the whole thing. So how it's all done, I have to send you to my friend Matt Raymer, because he's the co-founder with me.
I see.
But you know, it's a combination of having accesses to the account, having an API, you know, which is the secret back door to a video, for example, a channel. It's just one way or another. It's so much easier if you do it ahead of time. It's really challenging. I mean, I kind of sent you some links to examples of folks when they got taken down and how long it took their teams to get them back up. You know, I don't know, like, I don't know. Do you have like a whole team working behind you, Ben?
No, it's just me.
Solo show, yeah. So you're the one, you are the webmaster, you're like a one-man show. Yeah, so you understand that. When for you, like for you to get up on these other channels that I was mentioning that are resistant to censorship, you can imagine that that would kind of take you some time. Yeah, so that's the first step is, you know, for folks who are like, say, you know, you're kind of little, you're small fry, and you think, well, it's not going to happen to you right now, right? You're not going to ruffle someone's panties this week,
Oh, I might.
right? Well, but you, I know you want to. So, yeah.
I've had small run-ins. I mean, I haven't been deplatformed, but I've had small run-ins and little melees and stuff. Yeah, so I can understand the frustration when, you know, somebody kind of maliciously attacks you.
Yeah. So that's the small thing. You know, it's understandable that, you know, I kind of aim for two things, Ben, in the marketing that I run. One of them is the fear. And that's big because the censorship dragon is growing. It's a huge shadow that's going over people. But more than that, it's also the hunger, like to get a small cast like yours up on more channels, to get it up on social media. Have you heard of Hootsuite, for example?
Yeah,
You
I
know?
have, yeah.
Yeah, so Hootsuite, they would take your social media and make it replicated and go up properly in Facebook campaigns and Twitter campaigns. They would make sure that your social media gets up there on the regular. Well, yeah, we can do that at Content is Safe.
And
We
we
can
can.
hit all the regular channels like that too. It's just that the difference is we're going to touch all these other places that Hootsuite's not going to touch. And since we're kind of a startup, we're definitely doing it at like an intro price, which is different. So it's about saving you time, basically, and getting you up on more places, which is, you know, putting more eyes and ears on your work.
Yeah, that makes sense. Right. So you're providing several different things. You can do just simple content distribution, and but then you can also sort of focus on the deep, you know, safeguarding and planning against deplatforming. Just on a technical side of things, I know you said you're more on the marketing side rather than the coding and stuff, but is blockchain technology, is that a part of what you do? What's your view of that? What's your knowledge on that?
You know, I'm glad that you mentioned that because actually some of the tech we use at Content is definitely touching on that, because for the higher tier services, we're offering seed box storage, and that means that it's on a distributed ledger network. So we're talking, you know, completely distributed ledger European seed box storage of your content that's out there. And it's not like just like stuff that's put on the blockchain, it's not likely to be taken down. So it's really, really like bulletproof as far as it's out there. And it's out there with you having access to it.
Right, I
And
see. Yeah,
that's one thing.
because I was
Yeah.
thinking that, you know, what's to stop the new platforms being vulnerable, such as the one, I forgot what it was called, the Twitter alternative.
Gab. Yeah, well, you see, that's the thing. Gab was taken down recently. I mean, and they had to do a lot of work to get back up. We would have loved to be in place, like, way ahead of time, and then, you know, having offered our services right after the fact, because they would probably, you know, subscribe. They would see, oh, this is worth it. But right now, you know, kind of aiming for smaller fry, you know.
Just some changing gear slightly. In terms of, like... not necessarily like the website platform level, but in terms of like the day-to-day social interaction level. I mean, what's your view of that? Because I've had some frustrating experiences, because I've spent a lot of time in kind of quite liberal circles, quite left-leaning circles. I've spent a lot of time doing yoga and going to dance classes and circus school. It's all very liberal, very left-leaning. And just on that social level, I found it difficult to be more right-leaning, you know, because what you know it is, right? And I mean,
yeah, I'm living in it. I live on Hawaii, like the big island of Hawaii. It's very like that, you know.
I'm not familiar. I don't know anything about Hawaii. So yeah, go ahead and tell us.
Well, it's very simple. It's, I mean, to speak of the message of respect of choice is the way I aim it. Part of the thing is I had to take some years of training and not just critical thinking, which helped me lead towards the path of voluntarism and understanding boundaries, ownership, and property. But I had to train a way of understanding how people deal with their feelings. And the left-leaning folks that I think you were mentioning, and similar folks who, like, I would say are the majority here on Big Island of Hawaii, they go in that, they could be very emotionally based, so I need to understand how that works. So I kind of like, I aim for what is universal for folks generally. I try to, which is just to understand that most folks don't want conflict. And most folks do want boundaries. Boundaries actually preserve harmony. And when boundaries are crossed, that breaks the harmony. So when everyone knows who owns what, you get to have harmony. It's kind of amazing. And when some form of boundaries, ownership, or property is crossed, that's where you have conflict. And I just, you know, I try to go right for the base of it. You know, when I'm communicating to folks, like something complicated, and I usually find that I don't get so much pushback from folks. I would get like, there's three F's. You probably never heard of these, okay? Fight, flight, and freeze. So fight is where someone is directly angry that I mentioned something that they really didn't want me to mention. Like the gender pay gap seems to be bollocks, as you might say over there, right?
yeah.
That would be an example. And for the most part, I would get flight, meaning, oh, I didn't want to see that. So they just run away. They're not gonna communicate on Facebook about that with me. And for some, they might freeze if I'm speaking it out loud and I actually see them and I can actually see their expression, right? When I see the three F's happen, I'm usually trying to, you know, get back to the basis of what's the purpose of my interaction with this individual? And I usually, like, I have some degree of an understanding of what that is, whether they're my client, whether they're part of my social network over here, my physical 3D social network, whether there's some type of, I don't know, filial or family connection. I'm just trying to understand what's the purpose of our interaction. And I go back to that, like, what's the basis of it? That's usually where I start. I try to get it back on a solid level. I figured, do you do anything like that?
Yeah, it makes sense what you're saying. You sort of find the commonality as opposed to sort of being at the level of the differences. And my housemate actually, she started studying nonviolent communication, and I haven't studied it myself, but I recognize a few of the things you're saying. So I've got a loose familiarity with what you're saying, yeah.
It's really an amazing technology. There's like eight main components of it, but most people only use four of them. And unfortunately, if they're used in this weird standard way that it's too often taught, it sounds like this. Ben, when you told me you were going to be late to this whole podcast, I felt angry because my needs for being respected were not being met. Would you be willing to be more respectful in the future? That's what it could sound like. Okay.
Right.
So now, that's horrible. And that's really badly taught. And there are a lot of good teachers of NVC, nonviolent communication, out there, and they won't do that. what the way I tend to use and teach this method when I'm paid to teach that stuff is I go into it like, this is an inside job. You notice what it is that you observed, like, oh, Ben's running late. He's got a person on the other end. I notice what I'm feeling. I'm looking at the clock. I got a thing coming up, Ben. And okay, I'll do something. I'll get ready for the podcast. And then I'm feeling like, okay, I feel the tension. I feel the fear. I notice what it is that I want. That's a motive. And, you know, I want efficiency. I want to, like, make a smooth production with you because, you know, I tell myself the story that you're a professional over there and you made yourself successful. And what you've got, I want. So, like that. And then I figure out, how am I going to get to that? And I took my time as though I envisioned my day. I took a little time out to envision how my day is going to flow. And then I go back to, how am I feeling now? What am I thinking? And how is it going? So that's how I generally teach this kind of stuff. It's really too bad, Ben. Not enough people, they teach it as an exterior communication thing, not an inside job, you know?
Wow. It's based on 8 steps, is it? Is that the steps that you ran through in that example?
Those were 4 of them, see?
Okay.
That's the problem. They often teach just the 4. So the 4 steps are observations. Those are everything you can, with your 5 senses plus thoughts, that you would consider very relevant that you'd want to write down. And that's, they call them, in, you know, observations. And then it goes over to feelings. I like to simplify it just to the 4 core feelings: happiness, sadness, anger, and fear. And then from there, right under that, because it goes round in a clockwise, you know, we're starting at like, say, 9 p.m. at observations, and we're going over to 3, you know, kind of to, I no, what is it? Okay, we're going over from like 11, you know, 11 p.m. over there to, you know, to 2 o'clock, 11 o'clock to 2 o'clock is the feelings. Then you'd be going down under feelings to what they call needs. I don't use that word. I use values and desires. They are the abstract qualities that would be the motive. Like, for example, I had motives to speak with you today. I had motives to respond to your Facebook thread today. And those motives are abstract. They were connection. They were, you know, to communication, things like that. Those, they're abstract, right? So yeah, going it that way, those are, I call them values. And the last quadrant, that would be strategies and actions. And so you can go around in a clock like that with these 4 methods, just for starting from what's observed and what are the main thoughts, the things that are relevant to the situation. You call it like the data. And then what is the main feelings that are going on? I could have the happiness that I made it happen with you. I could feel a little bit of the fear because I'm on the spot and I'm talking. Even if I'm used to public talking, I'm still a little bit of the fear. You know what I mean, Ben? You know? And then you could go down under that so I can feel the, you know, the values that I'm aiming for, clear, precise communication, where like I have my inner mentor telling me, slow down, Darrell, you know, slow it down, give the message clearly. And then it gets me to my strategy and my action, which is, okay, I will slow it down. I will, you know, I'll keep this in mind. I'll make sure to be paying attention to Ben and what he wants, you know.
That's fascinating. I've never heard that. Yeah, was it, there was more?
You know, those are the 4 of the 8, you know. That's how that part works.
Do we get to hear all 8, or is that...
Yeah, you know, because you got me. You got me on the spot here. So the other 4 are called the 4 Ds of disconnected communication. You can consider them as 4 ways to... do you get to swear here?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, these are 4 ways to fuck up any relationship. Okay.
Okay.
Like 4 perfect ways of doing it. And on the flip side, there's 4, if you know how to translate them, then there's 4 ways that you can easily, like, reduce the tension in yourself whenever you encounter them coming at you, and hopefully prevent them coming out of you, or even make sure that someone can't even interpret them as any of these 4. So I'll give you the 4 now. Mm-hmm. First, it's demands. Any form of making demands, basically. So that's kind of hardcore, you know, making a demand, you know, like license and registration, please. That's one of the ones we often is dealt with in mainland USA, that kind of thing. That's not a request for license and registration. That's a full-on demand. That's why there's all this adrenaline running. Same thing with the lights, you know, pulling you over. That's a demand too. Now, when you deal with a demand from someone who doesn't have a gun, you can also consider that that's a request. So in other words, when you translate the demand, is that's them kind of making a kind of clumsy, semi-tragic request. That's cool. That's them tipping their hand. Why would they want that thing? Well, that's kind of like, you know, a little bit of discovery. So now they're becoming a human being instead of someone who's just demanding.
Mm.
You follow me on demands?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So here's the next one. It would be, that would be unrequested diagnoses. So that's the one where diagnoses of, you know, circus freak, if I was to give you that label, that's, it's an unrequested diagnosis. That's all you're good for. I can't believe that you're good at anything else. How could you be good at business, Ben? I don't believe it. I mean, I saw these pictures of you all painted up.
Right.
So,
right.
You know? So therefore I just label you as circus freak. You didn't ask for this diagnosis. See, like my other career as a licensed acupuncturist. Yeah, that's where I get paid to give a diagnosis because it's attached to a treatment plan that better be delivering results that people are, you know, paying for. Yeah. So most people, they give diagnoses because it's like them labeling stuff, you know, in the boxes when they move. They put like kitchen stuff on a box, you know, so they label you. They could label you also as business professional. It comes out as compliments too, you know.
Yeah.
So you could feel a little weird when you get compliments, and you can definitely feel the irritation when you get derogatory labels put on you, Ben, because they're an unrequested diagnosis. You didn't ask for it. You didn't pay for it. And it still landed on you. A simplistic label, like as if you were right-leaning or you're a conservative or, I don't know, pro-Trump or something, when that's not really a good, accurate version of you. So here's how to translate that, Ben. When someone is giving labels at you, you could translate that as they're seeking understanding. Just like when they wrote kitchen stuff on a box, they wrote all over you to try to understand you quickly. They didn't get the job done very well. So just understanding that they're a flawed human being who semi-tragically went about the act of labeling you because they labeled themselves and you and everyone in the whole world. That's what they were taught to do. And they're not really in the business of, I would say, doing the metacognition of knowing how they think, which is kind of what we're doing right now, Ben.
Right.
We're doing a little metacognition. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So you follow me on diagnoses and how that's like a desire for understanding?
Yes, completely. Yeah, perfectly clear.
Oh, cool. So here's this next one that you're going to encounter a lot, and you already have. Deserve-oriented thinking. You know, I deserve a livable wage. I deserve a universal basic income and free health care, Ben. What do you think, huh?
Right.
Yeah, right.
That sounds familiar, yeah.
Yeah, also, you deserve to be punished and taken off of social media because you said some things to my friend Sandra that I didn't like, so I'm going to try to get you a Facebook ban. You know, punishments and rewards, Ben. Deserve-oriented thinking, entitlement speaking, entitlement thinking. Now, to understand how to translate that, again, this is a semi-tragic way of thinking, okay? So what it's reaching for is it could be reaching for simply a desire for a form of equality or justice. It could be reaching for ease and efficiency. Like it would be so much easier if I didn't have to deal with seeing your face on Facebook for 30 days, you know. It could be reaching for something like the person was punished and rewarded in their own personal life. So they want a form of continuity. They want to see you punished or rewarded. You're a successful businessman, Ben, so I would like you to be rewarded, you know, for that. I would like that reward to happen to you because I was rewarded for my good things and I want that to be passed on. Mm-hmm. It's thinking in terms of continuity. If they were punished and rewarded, they like to have that power to dish that out too. you know. It makes their life seem more contiguous and less of this chaos of punishments and rewards that really was tragic. You see how that works? That
yes.
Kind of, you know, deserve-oriented thinking. It's kind of a semi-tragic way of them reaching for equality or justice or some form of continuity or ease or efficiency. Those are all in that values category that we went into, you know, the third method, the third part, you know. And I think you got me on that, so I can give you the last one.
Okay.
All right. It's denial of responsibility. It's very straight up. I, you know, had to pull you over because I saw that one of your lights was out. I had to yell at you, Ben, because you made me late for this next appointment that I've got going on. So it's not my fault. I deny responsibility for my actions. You know, I pin them on you. Kind of a form of projection, basically. And you can see that as a very seemingly childish-like desire for ease and efficiency. It would be so much easier if one wasn't responsible for one's own choices of actions or inactions. Right, Ben? Yeah. So you can see that when you translate them, each of these components, you can no longer see the person as the enemy. You can see them kind of like a child who's hurt. And just like all children out there, you know, you're not in a kind of a forced daycare situation. You can choose to help them or you can choose to show up strong, but you can choose to see whether are they trying to get your goat or are they just themselves really off balance, like a little kid, basically. And usually it's the latter. Usually they're not an intelligence operative trying to really get you. Usually, I'm going to say, usually they're just someone who's just, they're basically emulating the same behavior that was delivered to them. So so now you know, like, about, I don't know, a good amount of what NBC trainers and users do, like, around the world mostly. Because too many of them, they don't even use the 4 Ds of disconnected communication. And it's in Marshall Rosenberg's book, Nonviolent Communication.
Wow, you're tremendously good at explaining all this. I'm curious, how long have you been teaching nonviolent communication?
That's been, yeah, a good 8 years now.
I got a question for you. Something I'm never quite sure of. Like you were talking about just a moment ago, like blame or taking responsibility or denying responsibility. It seems to me that if you just put all the responsibility on the outside world and take no responsibility, that's too extreme at one end. But then at the other end, if you say you're responsible for everything and don't place any responsibility with others for the way they behave, that's also too extreme at the other end. And so what's the right balance?
That's a good point. So maybe there's a differentiation in definition, as that's critical thinking. So when I say responsibility, I was referring to the ability to respond. So can I respond to the clouds over me here in Hawaii? I can respond to them, but are they supposed to respond to me? Like, I don't have a weather control device. So people are like that too. No, I'm going to respond to other people's choices of action and inaction. That's on me. That's my response ability. That's where it comes from. But now cause and effect is a different thing. I think you were meaning that. When people are going to choose a certain cause, you know, a certain action, there's going to be a cause and effect. I'm going to take steps in my life to make the safety and security that I want, to make the clarity of communication that I want, to make the emotional and intellectual balance that I want in me. And I have the ability to do that in me. But I don't really have the ability to change what other people choose to do, see? Now, so when they choose to do things, I'm going to take steps. But that's as far as I get to go, pretty much. I don't know if I... Did I, like, really get to answer you, or did I, like, scoot away from that one?
Yeah, I was with you. And I kind of wanted to, like... I want to say, like, when is it appropriate within the nonviolent communication framework to to say, you know, to kind of to reject someone or dismiss them or say you're not behaving in a way that's acceptable to me? Like, you know, when is that appropriate under NVQ?
Well, see, first of all, you can just consider that these are tools, and so it's not a religion. So it's not like under voluntarism, when am I allowed to defend myself? You know, mm-hmm. It's like you get to defend yourself whenever you well, you know, please. Whenever you damn well please, basically. It's like that. So you get to choose who you spend your time with, especially who you spend your unpaid time with, mm-hmm. You know. And you get to choose to say, what's the cost and benefit of me explaining this to this person to say, in the future, I would prefer that you communicate to me without these four Ds, without any demands, without any diagnoses of myself that I didn't ask for, without any deserve-oriented language towards me, and without any denial of responsibility upon your internal thinking and feeling systems going on. Mm. Now, that could be a whole lot. Now, some people would be like, what? You know, they didn't follow me there. You know, that was way too dense. Some people say I'm too dense with the number of terms that I'm throwing out. I know. So keep this in mind, you get to do the cost-benefit analysis, Ben, where you'd say, I really like this person or I want them in my life for these reasons. So to optimize my relationship with them, I'm going to try to communicate a way of making agreements. And if they keep the agreements to not use these four Ds as an example, well, then that's great. That will build respect and trust and understanding and connection. And if they break these agreements, well, that's a sign that this could be too expensive of a relationship like that.
Mm. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. I want to ask you, what's your view of Stefan Molyneux and the way he communicates? I listen to him. I like him. I've been following him for years. And, you know, I listen to all his episodes. And what's your experience of him?
Well, that's a good question. I haven't gotten to listen to a Stefan Molyneux episode of Free Domain Radio in a long time. You know, he was very involved in the Liberty community in New Hampshire, where the School Sucks Project comes out of, and a lot of other places as well. He very much moved away from that community. He was receiving some, I would say, some good critique that he would, I think, been better served for facing instead of ducking and never speaking to. So his modern work I'm not familiar with. His ancient work, though, I could say this. All of us can give Stefan Molyneux great credit for helping promote the idea to be way physically kinder and to remove physical violence from children as much as possible in stopping spanking. Really appreciate him for that. I really appreciate him for taking a deep look at the history of World War I and World War II and other historical elements. And I found great value in some of the older works of Stefan Molyneux. I found great criticism in how it seemed like he was, whenever evidence would pop up that would be contrary to some of his strong conclusions, he would just run away instead of face it. And that would, you know, in certain scientific disciplines, which I don't think he honestly has the acumen or background to really like, you know, having made, he basically would appeal to authority. That's the logical fallacy. He would appeal to certain other scientific authorities in certain medical cases, for example, and then just move on and case closed for him. Mm. So there's elements where I find like great value that he gave, especially years ago. And there's parts where I'd find concerning, where not open to criticism. I always find that disturbing. But now I'm going to throw it back to you, Ben. What value have you been getting from Stefan Molyneux?
I really like him, and I can't think of any criticism. I enjoy listening to him. I particularly enjoy when people call in, like the call-in show, and people call in with their family stuff and stuff to do with their childhood and, you know, abuse and trauma and relationship stuff and things to do with their family. Those are kind of my favorite ones. I like the way he deals. So there's nothing in particular that I don't have any criticisms of him, but I was just really curious because, you know, I know some people find him controversial, and yeah, I was curious to hear another perspective. So yeah.
Well, yeah, please keep in mind that, you know, I could name like a slew of alternative media producers who literally don't have a connection to Stefan any longer, but were on like, you know, personal basis, you know, they got his phone number kind of people, you know, and that's a lot of people to distance oneself from. And these are a lot of very reasonable people that I've been in business with for years. So that's kind of a warning sign. And there's been, you know, there's a lot of signs like that. So it's good to be, it's really, really good to be critical. You know, it's this in the same way, it's good to see, like, that's a, it's a big warning sign. It'd be a bigger warning sign, Ben, if you were going to go into business with him. But as someone who's just passively taking in his content and taking the value for it, there's no problem, you know?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I don't want to press you to go into any particular detail if you don't want to, but was there specific topics? I mean, it's up to you if you want to get into it.
Topics. So, topics of seeming of support of Donald Trump, for example, would be a modern one. But more ancient would be the topics of the a rational and evidence-based discussion of the evidence to look at vaccinations and what has happened with them across the, I would, you know, certainly across the decades, especially more modernly, and things of that nature, to really open the book like that, to open up and look at real things like that, to you know, I would say just some of it seemed like, you know, just like where he would show up to Liberty festivals like Pork Fest, the Porcupine Freedom Festival, and he would be going there, and he no longer goes there. And there's many other, you know, North American Liberty conventions and festivals. I don't really know of him showing up to any of them, basically. I don't really understand that, personally speaking, because he had like a humongous like opening and venue in that direction. But a lot of it was just simply very personal. It seemed like of taking any form of criticism very personally, I think that would be the biggest red flag. And it was like, hey, why did you not have an open-minded look at various evidence and open this door instead of just claiming that you know doctors and they say that you're wrong and therefore he doesn't have to talk about it, you know? And that's kind of, you know, I guess the sign of, you know, it basically, I have a desire for my value of consistency. Like, in other words, we're having a rational discussion, you and I, Ben, because it's intellectually consistent. And if I was in the future to bring up things that would be pointing out signs of your inconsistency, I would hope that your desire for self-discovery would be greater than your desire to be right, you know? Mm-hmm. And I would say that it seems like from my friends who were, you know, on a first name calling him up basis with Steph, you know, that was kind of the problem, was he was just not on that wavelength of being really ready for criticism and handling it. And that's pretty troubling, you know?
Yeah, that's fair. There was a really powerful moment that really stood out for me that I remember when he did a show, an episode with Adam Kokesh. And I remember him, he was talking to someone else, and he said, Adam Kokesh is not my friend. And I remember that. It just struck me as a powerful, like a very definite, you know, thing to say. And I'm not saying I agreed with either of them, you know, on the issues they were discussing. You know, I'm not sure how I feel about it, but it just really stood out how definite he was in saying that, you know.
Yeah, this happens too often. So my opinion on that is, it's just like there was always a missing component of critical thinking going on, and certainly all the methods that I just gave you of nonviolent communication also missing. And because there's a, you know, like there's a methodology for how to think effectively, that where you define your terms, friend, for example, in that case. And I think that if Steph did have like had trained his mind with critical thinking, and he had trained his emotional response systems with something like nonviolent communication, or at least, you know, or that system, which I gave you, he would be instead be like, okay, there's something here in our relationship I would like to reduce, and there's things that I want to increase. So what are those? And just name them, you know? And it's like that. Instead, he likes to put simplistic labels on it. That's a diagnosis. Friend, not my friend, like that. And then quickly dismiss it. See, like, it's the same as writing a label on a box. It's very quick, it's down and dirty, but it really misses the nuance of, like, knowing what the goals are.
Yeah.
So, you know, in the case of Adam Kokesh, I can imagine, you know, look, there's certain things that sketch me out about this guy and this doing this, this, and this, and this, and I want to distance myself from those things especially, so to do that, I have to distance myself from Adam. That would be concise. That would be more precise, I would say, nuanced. But instead, you know, this is not really fair to Steph, I got to say, because I didn't hear that quote, and I didn't, and I'm lacking the context for even why he might have done that.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, it's okay. Yeah,
let's strike that from the record.
That's yeah, that's okay. It's
not fair. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's okay. I was just curious. I want to be respectful of your time because I know you got other stuff to do. Do you have time for us to get into the Trivium stuff a little bit?
I want to save that for the next show. If you're going to give me another show,
oh, you will. Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah, I will. I'll give you that other show. I just want to make mention, like, you know, because I'd like to love to really talk to you really soon off the air about this one. But, you know, besides the stuff that I was mentioning about content is safe that I was giving out as services, there's also about payment platforms I want to make mention.
Sure.
So when you're receiving payment for something like Patreon or even PayPal, those are things that can also get shut down. And I just wanted to put a plug in to say, we got some workarounds for that also. Also, same thing for your domain and your hosting. So that's pretty, you know, so I thought that would be like good little food for thought. And yeah, for critical thinking and the Trivium method, I'd be so psyched. We'll schedule a time and we'll make it awesome.
Yeah, sure. I'm happy to do that. And so just remind us again, the website that people need to go to find out all about these services.
Sure. You can check out contentissafe.com, and that's going to take you right to our business, be helping you get ready for a world of deplatforming and boost your site up onto a whole lot of places in a skillful way so you don't spend your time and money doing it on your own. I don't know how much your time is worth, Ben. Probably a lot. But, you know, every hour that you spend slowly uploading, you know?
Yeah, yeah, sure. I'm glad you think my time is worth a lot of money, and I won't dispel that image you've got of me, so that's fine. Just on a personal level, what are you up to today? I mean, what's your day? What do you spend your time doing on a normal day?
On a normal day, I kind of jump around between the island businesses that I attend to and that involves acupuncture and holistic medicine and providing services for people here on island. I have certainly like to do some bit of similar logistics where I'm talking with people like you, Ben, on the phone or, you know, other electronic connections who are around the world where I'm trying to just manage their own whatever's going on with their business situation. It's actually pretty exciting.
I tell you what we'll do next time. We could talk more about the health and the holistic therapies and the body and the spiritual stuff and Hawaii and the Trivium. So are you happy to leave it there and then we'll get into all that next time?
I'm totally happy, and I'll be so psyched to listen to this one when you get it done.
Awesome. I'll put it up soon. It'll be up within a few hours, so I'll send you the link.
Oh, that's so sweet. Thanks so much for your time, Ben. It's been great.
You're welcome. Thank you, too. I'll speak to you soon, Darrell.
All right. Thanks, Ben.
Cheers. Bye-bye.